Today is the last day of class in here, all right? Which is probably why I am a little goofy this morning, all right? The semester is tough on everyone. So what we're going to do today is we're going to wrap up like the one essential thing that I wanted to talk about. You know, I always have in my mind like the stuff that I absolutely want to talk about, and then there's like, you know, if you give me time, I'll figure out something to talk about, right? And I don't even mean that like, you know, we'll talk about the weather or whatever, but... Yeah, right. You know, there's always topics. You know, this course could be double the credit hours, and we'd still have no trouble filling it up. You know, we could go over it, you know, we'd just go over more stuff. But for this specific class, the one thing that I want to go over is, what if you want to do an insert? And again, the same thing would apply for an update and delete, but I'm just going to do it with an insert. What if I wanted to do an insert not using the built-in components of ASP.NET? Now, there'd be reasons why I would want to do that, all right? And we'll talk about the reasons a little bit, then we'll actually go and do it to see. So let's say, for example, that getting back to our summer league thing, let's say we had the ability for the user to put down some notes, all right? Just a place like a diary or a to-do list or whatever. So like on their registration page, when they have logged on, you know, there could be something like, there's practice next Tuesday, or the money for the candy sale is due on June 10th or whatever, you know. Just like you could put notes in about the player. You know, the player could do that for themselves. Now let's think about what that screen would look like. Right now, our login screen, and we can just leave it like this. Right now, the screen looks like this. We have a details view of the person's information. So we have name, or first name, last name, all the other attributes. All right? Remember, how did we get to that page? We got to that page through the login, and it knows who to bring up because we have in the session variable the user ID or the player ID. All right. Let's say we wanted the ability to go and add a comment. So we have an add comment button here, all right? And then underneath that, maybe we showed a list of the comments that they already added, all right? Now, what would a table for that look like, all right? Table would probably look something like this. It'd be a comment ID, right? Because a person could have multiple comments, you know? You wouldn't want to make this a one-to-one relationship where there'd be one comment per player and so on. That doesn't really make sense. There'd really be no need for an additional table if there was just one comment. There'd be a comment field that was part of the main table. So what we have is we have a one-to-many relationship between player and comment. One comment relates to one player. A given player can have multiple comments. So there'd be a foreign key in here, a player ID. That'd be the date of the comment. And finally, that'd be the actual comment text itself. Now, details view and grid views are very good when we are manually entering in everything into the database columns. So like for the player, first name, where does that come from? Well, you type in the first name. Last name, where does that come from? Well, you type in the last name. Skill level, where does that come from? You pick the skill level from the drop down. and so on and so forth. In other words, every one of those fields except for the player ID, which is auto-generated, so we really don't have to worry about it. But every single one of those fields, we're entering in manually. All right. So a details view works great for that, and a grid view would work great for that. However, if you think of this comment ID, that's going to be generated. Player ID, that's going to come from the session variable. Date of the comment, that's just going to be the system date. And comment text, that is manually entered. So in this case, our insert statement would be something like this, insert into comments. Player ID, date comment, comment text, values, ?? Two of those values are going to come from elsewhere other than manually being entered. All right, one of them is going to be manually entered. That's not really how detail views work or grid views. Again, detail views and grid views work best when you're manually entering everything in. So we're stuck with our age-old dilemma when you're using a framework. And again, one thing I try to do in this class is talk about the specific case, but also generalize it. Because we can figure out how to do these specific things, and that's great. But some of the things that we do have relevance beyond a specific case. And this is a classic case that we have a framework to do something, all right? But it doesn't do exactly what we want it to do. So, we're stuck with essentially two options. Number one is to figure out a way to work this functionality into the framework. All right? That'd be possible. Might not even really be that hard. I really haven't thought about that in too great of detail because I always use this as an example of custom coding. The other option is to say, forget the framework, I'm going to do it myself in this case. Either one of them is a valid approach. And I want to have examples in class of where we do both. And we have had examples in class where we've done both. We've gone in and we've customized a framework to allow for error catching, for example. All right? So we worked with the framework. We didn't like exactly how the framework worked. So we put in template columns. And we put in error trapping in the item inserted, item deleted events. All right? Here, though, we're going to say, fine, we're going to do it ourselves. So what I'm going to do is I'm first going to define this table, and then I'm going to go in and add to that table an insert for a comment. All right? So that's our goal for today. So any questions before I proceed with those?
On that chart, it was a text box button, yep. And then what was underneath?
Oh, what this would be is this, what I was thinking of is this would show all the comments that were previously entered.
That'd be like a grid view, right.
Right. So in other words, I could have added in three comments last week or whatever. This would show me all the comments that were there, and then this would allow me to add a new one. We could even then, if you want to get fancy, and again, depending on time, we may or may not do this, you could go and make that grid view editable and deletable so that you could go in and edit a comment if you spelled it wrong or delete it if it was no, you know, you got your candy money in, so you delete it off the list or whatever.
That you already
had entered in, right. But you could do that right on the grid view, all right? Thank you. and has anyone signed up for classes yet?
Yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. How many of you have me?
Yes.
Oh, my condolences. Well, you know, you get at least a few weeks break.
Is the scripting class good?
It's horrible.
Good.
I'm actually thinking of revising it a little bit to account for more mobile stuff.
Okay.
All right. Like, you can do some cool things scripting-wise, for example, to do geolocation. You know, so I could, for example, I could find out where I was and display where the closest store was. You know, let's say I'm on Walgreens website. You know, there's a Walgreens every three blocks, right? But I could, if I went on the Walgreens website, it could look to see where I was, look to see where the closest Walgreens is, and then put that in. So far, that functionality has been in the mobile web development class, but I might sneak some of that functionality into that class just because that's a good thing. You know, even, you know, you're a web developer, right? You're not a mobile web developer. I'm developing mobile websites. No, you're developing websites, and you want to make sure they work in a mobile context. As my daughter would say, I'm feeling very chatty today. I think it's the excitement about the end of the semester and the two cups of coffee I had.
Probably the coffee.
Yeah, probably the coffee.
What's the class code for that class?
Pardon me?
What's the, like, it's CISS?
For what?
For the one you guys were just talking about.
The one we were talking about is CISS 232.
232.
The one that I mentioned at the end was CISS 268.
That's the mobile.
That's the mobile web.
Why is that one not part of the development association?
It is now. Or it will be.
Okay.
That was an oversight. And we're making changes to that, and as possible, we'll make further changes in the future.
So when is that going to be added?
Pardon me?
When's it going to be added?
In the web development class right now, it is, it'll be added as an elective. You could either take that or multimedia.
Oh.
Okay.
It's not like a requirement.
It's not a requirement.
It's like an Android.
Right now, it's not listed as one of the valid electives that you can take. But here's, like, you know, a pro tip, as they say. If there's something in your curriculum that you want to do something different, talk to the professor, right? Because... And this is great. This is where it's like I feel like Dumbledore or something. I feel very powerful, right? It's like I can change those requirements. You know, I can say, all right, for you, I'm allowing you to substitute mobile web development for multimedia. And I'd be glad to do that for anyone, you know. So if you're thinking of taking that course, if you're in the web development curriculum.
Tell us
now. Wait, tell us now. I literally need like two classes.
Right. But yeah, I mean, or like, you know, even something goofy like a science elective, you know, it's like there's a list of a couple science electives.
Man, like, what?
I still didn't take a science elective.
I took a
15-hour
chemistry class over the summer. Yeah. I could have died in.
Well, again, let's back up. Let's back up because there's some disclaimers here. It depends on the program that you are taking in. All right, and it has to be valid. You can't say, well, I'm supposed to take, quantum mechanics as my elective, and I want to take macrame instead, you know.
Right.
So we're not going to, like, waive anything. Right. But if it's reasonable, if you want to take, say, like, let's say if your choices were chemistry and biology, and you want to take physics, it's like, yeah, I'd sign off on that, you know. I mean, that's, you know, why not?
General chemistry. It was horrible.
Really?
I was trying to take astrology. There's a, like...
I was I love science, but I just chemistry did. It's funny. The thing I found is like there's certain things that I just don't fit in my head right. You know. Pardon me.
I said chemistry is.
Chemistry was one for me, definitely. Physics, I did did great in physics. And I even like did good in chemistry. I mean, it wasn't like I failed it or anything. But like, it was one of those things where like, I'm memorizing this for the test, and the day after the test, I'm not going to know anything about it, you know? I'm going to be one of those that's going to be afraid of the internet meme talking about how dangerous hydrogen dioxide is, right? you know, whereas physics, it's like, I still remember some of the physics, you know?
Because physics are, like, used a lot
in the
real world. So.
Right, I mean, exactly.
Chemistry isn't, but...
Right. Yeah. I remember how I kept accelerating even after I hit the concrete when I fell going down the hill. You know, that's vividly.
As I tripped.
Exactly.
Going through my head.
It's like, yes, a body in motion tends to stay in motion. Okay. That's why my eye is swollen shut, you know.
I was on the ground 9.2 seconds.
Yeah, right.
No, it's like when you fall every second, it's an extra 22 miles per hour or something.
Right. Right. Well, yeah, and at my height, no wonder. You know, if I'd been shorter, I might have been okay. All right, so let's go ahead and change the table to add, or change the database, rather, to add the new table here. So, create. Suspicious that comment or comments could be a reserved word, so I'm going to say something like comment table or player comment. There we go. And I'm going to make the primary key player. Comment ID or player comment if you will. And then there's going to be a foreign key for player ID. Remember having a discussion with a student when I told them I did not know how to type. And they're like, of course you know how to type. I'm like, no, I don't. It's like, well, you had to have learned how to type. No, I did not learn how to type. I mean, I just by doing this for 100 years, I kind of have an idea where the keys are, but I am looking at the keys every single time I type. And if my fingers are off a little bit, I will never notice, you know? And anyhow. All right. And finally, the actual comment itself. Short text, there's a short text, a long text, which again, the difference being like how much text you can put in. I'm just going to use a short text because these are just meant to be little reminders. You probably didn't notice, but a couple weeks ago was when we changed the clock, so it's actually 10:45. but that's okay. That's okay.
It's like 10 minutes apart. I was already late. It's 10 minutes apart too.
Oh right, yeah.
The parking
lot's
full.
Right. I did have a hard time finding a yeah. I'll give you that one.
Yeah, all right. Bad enough that you're late.
Wasn't really matter what.
I'm going to make that required because we have to have one of these. And I think that's it. And then I'll go in and I'll create the relationship. Again, this is essential to do, to go in and create the relationship. Because, just because we have defined it as having the same name, doesn't mean that it establishes a foreign key. All right? In fact, just because we go and connect them like that, that doesn't establish a foreign key. You actually have to click this that says enforce referential integrity. Do you think I would want to cascade delete here?
No. Did the player you wrote on the comments do?
You could probably make an argument either way, but I'm thinking, yeah, if a player's quitting, you know, they don't need to know anymore that, you know. This would be an example of a dependent relationship, all right? In other words, a comment doesn't make any sense if without a player associated with, all right? Compare that to, let's say there was a student and faculty advisor, you know, a student had a faculty advisor. All right, and there was that relationship. If the faculty member retires, does the student disappear? Like you'd be going into graduate, it's like, I'm sorry, your advisor retired. You have to drop out of school, you know? That doesn't make sense, right? Because the student is an independent entity. There really is a student, and that student may have a relationship to a faculty advisor, but that student's existence doesn't depend on the faculty advisor's existence. I mean, that sounds a little cosmic and philosophical, but if you think about it, that student is its own entity, and it has a relationship to that, but you could get rid of the one, and the other one still needs to be here. Whereas a comment, you get rid of the player, comment doesn't really make sense anymore, all right? It doesn't really have a existence except attached to a player. So I'm going to cascade deleted related records. Now, the one case where I might say that is if it was something other than comments. If it was, for example, outstanding fees, right? It would be, if there's outstanding fees, it would be like, oh, okay, I'm going to delete my player record. Oh, not so fast. You still owe us money, right? Whereas a comment doesn't really seem to have that sort of importance associated to it. All right. So, I'm going to go in and change that one field name to player comment, again, for the same reason, just because comment could be reserve word. So we have player comment ID, player ID, comment date, and player comment. All right. So I'm going to go in here, and I am not going to create a details view and all that stuff. Because remember, we're doing this not attached to the framework. We're writing this code on our own. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to put in two things. Well, the first thing I'm going to put in is I'm going to put in a text box for the comment. And then I'm going to put, let's get this working first, and I'll go and put the grid view in. All right. So I want to write some code here. So one way I can get to this is by double-clicking it. It'll take me right to the event. And let's go back and look at this guy. Because for this to work, that onClick event has to be wired to the ASP.NET control. All right. I had someone in lab on Tuesday. I don't remember who, but they sort of had a div on top of a button, and they couldn't click on the button to get there. All right. If you could not get to the button, what you do is you type in on click. Equals, and then you'd say create new event. Alright, and then you could put the code in for that. That's why it's important to know both like the GUI way to do it and the code way to do it. Yes?
On like a grid view or details view, uh-huh. they have the insert, edit, delete, or whatever on there.
Right.
Can you add on clicks to those? So I was trying to do that, and I could not figure out how to do it. And even going to like the source code, they don't have any like...
I don't think so, because... What do you want to do it for?
Well, like say for a delete, if you had a delete on your grid view, you add like a on click confirm field.
Are you sure you want to?
Yeah, stuff like that.
Okay. Well, you don't want to do that then on the grid view. What you would want to do is the way to do that would be number one, keep in mind this is different than default logic, right? So you would make that a template column. Right. All right, that's the first thing that you'd do. Then you would select the link that says delete. And on that, you would put on client click, because you probably want a confirmation box to pop up on the client side.
Okay.
So that's how you'd handle that one. A lot of times, don't feel bad if I ask you why do you want to do that, because a lot of times when I hear something that doesn't, like, I can't really connect, like, the motivation behind it, like, why would you want to do that? It's because there might be, like, a better, cleaner way to do it that wouldn't require you to do that. It's not like I'm just giving you a hard time or whatever, you know. I heard a comedian talk about how some music store clerks are really arrogant because they're frustrated that they're not rock stars or something, so... it said she went in and wanted to buy a guitar, and the person asked them, you know, what do you want to use the guitar for? And it's like, what do you think I want to use it for, you know? So it's not a case of that. It's a case of a lot of times when I hear something that doesn't ring true, it's like there's like the question behind the question. And I think that's important sometimes to get to the bottom of it before proceeding. Alright, so we have that code. Now, we've seen a lot of this code already. Alright, what do I mean by that? We have code already that is not associated with a details view or a grid view. Right? We did that in the case of a logon. In the logon, we looked at it and said, you know, we could use the built-in stuff in for the login and so on and so forth, but we could just as well write our own. So on our default page, I actually have a lot of the code that we're going to use here. So I'm going to copy this, and then we're going to change it. Alright, let's see how we're going to change it. Do we need a data source? We still certainly need a data source. We certainly need the object that controls accessing the database. Does that data source have a provider? Of course it does. Does it have a connection string? Of course it does. Does it have a select command? No. We're doing an insert here, so we don't have a select command. What command do we have? An insert command. So therefore, I say insert command and I put in what my insert command is. Insert into player comment. What are my columns? We don't need to put in the player comment ID, right? That's an auto number. We do need the player ID. We do need the comment date. And we do need the player comment itself. I think that's all we need. Let me go back and verify. Player comment. Player comment ID is going to be auto number generated. We need the player ID. We need the comment date. And we need the player comment. All right, so those are the three things that we need. We then need to supply the values. And what are the values? Very good. Oh, you guys remembered. Question mark, question mark, question mark.
Question mark's always the answer.
We don't know what they are. It depends on, it's going to be a parameter, it's going to be filled in at runtime. We don't know what the player ID is, but we know there's going to be a player ID there that's going to come from somewhere. So anytime you have a parameter like that, you represent it by a question mark. All right. So now we have to supply values for those question marks. Now are they insert or, yeah. Gave away the answer. Are they select parameters? Nope, they're insert parameters. All right. And there for player ID. Comment date.
That object, well, OBJDS, mm-hmm. Is that something we just made up? That's just a variable we made?
Yeah, it's a variable we made. It's a type of SQL data source. But yeah, here is where we're declaring it.
Will we have to change that because it's in another place of the code, or we just change in the select code that was already?
How do I want to put this? The SQL data source, that's your pipeline of the database.
Mm-hmm. Right.
All right. And it's the same pipeline if you're doing a select and bringing stuff in, or if you're telling it to do an insert.
Okay.
All right. So it doesn't matter what you're doing with the database. You'll always create a SQL data source to coordinate the interaction between the two. Now, what we're changing in this example is the example I brought up from the logon was doing a select. So we're going to do change where we're doing a select to do an insert. Now, three question marks means three parameters, right? We need to specify where these three things are coming from. So player date, comment date, and player comment. All right, where's the player ID coming from? Well, it's coming from the session variable. I forgot the name of the session variable.
Player ID.
Pardon me?
Player ID.
Yeah, session player ID. All right. All right. Giving us an error. We'll finish this up and then we'll go back and look at the errors. Where's the comment date coming from? Today's date. How do we tell today's date in C#? I'm studying music now, and we are now in the key of, we're studying the key of A flat major, and C# is actually the same as D flat. So that will have to be my way of remembering that A flat major is the programming key, all right, because you play C#. Yeah, the more you know, right.
Programming.
You never heard of it.
And finally, where is the player comment from me coming from? It's coming from the text box, which I probably cleverly call text box 3.
Apparently, the text box 3 is a
All right. Doesn't like anything.
Except
that. All right, why do you suppose it doesn't like these things?
Because they're... You're not using the right name space.
All right.
Do you need a table name?
No.
Because it's an uninsert.
Problem is it's expecting these guys to be strings. All right, so I'm going to hope there's a two-string method.
Hope there's one.
Yay.
As long as you get rid of the other line, it's all
right. Right.
Even if you have a runtime error, it doesn't matter. As long as you run
it. Yeah, right. From a select statement to an insert statement was like really straightforward. Just wherever we saw select, we put insert and then changed the rest of the stuff. Here's where it gets trickier. Because here, our job is actually easier. Alright, so this is actually simpler for us to do. Why is it simpler for us to do? It's simpler for us to do because a select returns stuff that you have to go in and look at. An insert either works or doesn't. All right? Insert either works or doesn't. So therefore, I don't have to, like, put the result somewhere and blah, 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 blah. I just have to go and say, go and do the insert. So I can lop off all of this stuff from here to here. And I can say OB.
That's good. That's good. That's good.
Should be okay.
That is
Captain Jean-Luc Picard saying make it so. Alright?
Is this the reason why my code is not working in mind? Because I didn't put that one line.
That's an open-ended question. It could be. Again, if you remember I said we'd cover this on Thursday and I kinda gave you some very vague instructions.
No,
and yeah, so this is that very well could be.
Nice.
Yeah, right. So that says it, go ahead and does the insert. Now, what should we probably do here?
Make it so.
We don't need the data reader anymore.
We don't need the data reader because we're not reading any data. We're just saying, go and insert this.
Yeah.
We're not retrieving some data that we're going to go and do something with. All right? We should find out if it worked or not. All right? Remember, we don't get a result set, but it could not work. Now, what would make a select statement, or I'm sorry, an insert statement not work? Well,
syntax,
go ahead.
Like syntax error.
Syntax error, yeah, possibly. Other possibilities? Well, a duplicate primary key would cause it not to work. We shouldn't have that problem because the database is generating the primary key. So that shouldn't be a factor, but that is one thing in general that could make an insert fail. Conforming. conforming to the database constraints. So for example, player ID is a foreign key from this table to the player table. All right. What if in a horrible case of bad luck, I was going to put a comment in as someone deleted that. That player wouldn't be there. I'd try to do the insert, and there would no longer be the player ID that corresponds to that, and that would get an error. Or if I tried to stuff something that wasn't a date into a date field, or if I left out something that was required, all right? All these things are things that could potentially give a error. So what am I going to do about that? We don't have a data view or a details view or a grid view, so we don't have any place to put that after inserted or item inserted. We just go back to our basic Paul Norod try catch, right? So we go try. Catch. I'm gonna pretend I don't know the precise syntax of this, just to show you how you Google stuff like this. I was convincing, wasn't I? I mean, it's almost like I actually didn't remember exactly how to do this.
I just want to copy and paste it.
Now, we could get clever. All right. We could get clever and look for some specific errors, but I'm pretty well confident I know that, you know, that there's only a handful of things that could be wrong, all right? So what I'm going to do is I'm simply going to put, you know, can insert at this point. So what the name was. I actually gave it a good name for one. Yeah, I'm looking for like label 27, you know. Notice my confidence there. I didn't say we'd test to see if it works. I said we'll verify that it works. So I'll go in and say, you know, practice. Tomorrow. Save comment. All right. Now notice that it didn't
do much.
All right. And that's what we'll go back and we'll fix with the last few minutes of class. But it didn't give us an error. So I'm pretty confident that if I look at that database in the player comment table, I wish I had a mic so I could just like do the mic drop and just walk out. Of course, then I'd have to like walk back in and finish up the lecture, but oh well. All right, so the basic bare bones functionality works. But again, the one thing I've tried to emphasize this semester is look at this and think like, if I was actually using this code, would I like how that behaves? From a technical perspective, it did what I sought out to do, but it's probably not terribly useful, all right? What would make it terribly useful? Well, I could put a grid view that would show the stuff that was already entered. I could sort it by date and so on, all right? So let's go and do that, and then we'll address your question. So let's go to here, and I'm going to put here, a grid view, and data source, configure data source, connection string, next. It's funny, I'm so used to like narrating what I'm doing simply because sometimes you can't always see on the video or whatever, that I find myself like when I'm cooking dinner, like narrating what I'm doing. It's like, okay, I'm cracking the eggs and putting them in the bowl, all right, now I get a fork and I whisk them up and put them in the microwave for 30 seconds and, you know, so.
Cooking with Zellers.
Yeah, cooking with Zellers.
It's going to be a YouTube series.
Yeah, that could be your other YouTube series.
Yeah, there you go.
So you get the YouTube money.
I did discover, and again, this probably sounds really stupid, but like the rest of the class hasn't had its goofy moments, but I discovered you can microwave eggs, and they come out really good when you microwave
them. Yeah,
you
said that. That's like you're microwaving your eggs.
Well, you scramble them to get like a nice like omelet like like thing. So you know it's really weird. It's like I'm going to heroic efforts to make it look like the manufactured genetically engineered eggs that you get like at McDonald's or Burger King, right? Because it's like, oh, God knows I don't want to eat a real egg, but I want to eat a real egg that looks like a fake egg. You know. Anyhow, advance. I'm going to generate the insert update and delete. For this, all right, finish. Then I'm going to go and probably should have put an order by on here. So let's go back and do that. Because remember, by definition, if you don't specify an order by, it gives it to you effectively in the order that it wants to. All right? I'm going to go and edit this grid view because I really don't need to see. I really don't need to see the IDs. Alright, and now I'll go and run this. I not do? Right. I forgot to put a where clause on my SQL statement, right? Because it is showing me, even though I'm not logged in, it's showing me my comments. So either I've used the ESP control to read my mind and find out who I am, which is probably not likely, or I forgot to put a where clause on here. Yeah, right. And it's funny because I had, between the last 2 weeks, I've had several forms of the same question. I don't remember who asked it, but something of the effect of, every time I log in, I see the same person every time. All right, and why is that? Because you have a details view that you forgot to put a where clause in, so your details view retrieves everyone and you see the first person. So I'll put a where clause in here, where player ID equals a session variable, and that session variable is player ID. All right, so now I'm going to go and log in. I'll go back and test it for someone that's not logged in a minute here. And there we go. There I am with my comment. And I go in and put in another comment like, you know, remember candy money. I have not typed a word correctly the first time this entire lecture.
So it doesn't post back.
Doesn't automatically refresh. No. Interesting.
Can you like add a refresh?
Okay. How can we go and make this work?
Press F5.
Repeat that, please.
On the button click, like, run the select statement again.
On the button click, run the select statement again. And we can do it the brute force way, or we can do it the smarter way. What's the brute force? Does everyone get what's going on? It's retrieving the stuff, but it's doing that retrieve, and it's populating that grid view before I have executed the insert statement. So in other words, if I were to insert another one, it's going to show me, if I insert comment 3, after I'm done, it's going to show me comment 1 and 2. So it's going to be one behind, because the insert for the new comment happens after the retrieve of the old comments. So if I put in test, I lied. Okay.
It doesn't do anything after that, I'm assuming.
Comments are all there. All right. So I could go and just say refresh. I could redirect back to itself. Not a good idea because it's already calling itself back. What is a command to refresh that grid view?
Escape.
Grid view
dot refresh.
One dot. Well, let's look through here. Let's see if there's a refresh. Every framework or language I've ever worked in, there's always like the things that you look at and say, it's amazing. All I have to do is do this and it does all that stuff for me. And then there's something that's like so simple, like you would think it would have to be in the language, and it isn't. Or it's called a goofy name or something.
Hey! Stack Overflow, you got us, man.
Stack Overflow. Get the hook up.
I am a teacher at a small community college in Ohio. I have just gone in and done such and such.
Oh, man.
Oh, this is redirecting back to that.
He's doing a redirect. This is like the one piece of code I've seen on Cyberpunk. I can actually understand.
Data bind.
What?
Yeah, the little line of code works, I'm so happy.
What does data bind have to do with refresh?
Well, you're telling it to rebind the data with, yeah. And I'm not sure why it didn't, I'm not sure why we're not one behind like I thought we were, like I thought would be. I can understand why it doesn't, well, we'll see. Let's make sure this works before I go on any further. I should probably clear out that text box so I can say text box 3. So we go right to that. So I go here and of course you blow up because there's nothing there. There's no player ID. So what can we do to fix that? Whoops.
On the button click, you can redirect to the login page. If there's no session ID.
Possibly.
On the page load, you could have an if statement that if the session ID is null, then just make that the text box not visible.
Right.
We
could hide it if it isn't there. If there's no session variable there, and therefore they won't see it. Now, what would I want to hide, really? I'd want to hide
the button.
The button? I could just hide the button.
Yeah.
I could just hide the button in the text box. But really, the button, the text box, and the grid view are all, not needed if they're logging on. So how do we handle that? How do we handle doing all three of them? Pardon me?
Put them all in a container and then hide the container.
Put them all in a container in a panel. Alright. Again, there's nothing horribly wrong with doing that, but if there were more things that were added on later, that says, well, in addition to seeing the player information and the comments, you also saw their team's won loss record, you also saw their batting statistics and pitching statistics and all that. You'd want all of that to only show if they were logged on. So the best way to ensure that would be, I'm going to create a panel. I'm just going to drag that over there. And then this is the kind of things I usually find better in code view. I'll go in and say, why copy the 16 lines of code? Just move the end tag.
Just move the end tag.
Yeah. Okay. So now we should be all set. All right. Oh, not quite yet. We put the panel. I would want to then, in the code behind, for the page load, if it's null, go into insert mode and, oh yes, by the way, hide panel one. All right, so now when we go and run this, we don't see any of that. In fact, it's not even like it gets sent. Yeah, because if we view the source, just not there at all. All right. And we probably should still work test this to make sure it works when you are logged in, right?
That would probably help.
And it does. Nice. Or does it? All right. I still would not be comfortable with that amount of testing. I would want to do what? I would want to register someone. I would want to go in and change someone. And I'd want to go in and add a comment for someone and make sure all those things worked. But I didn't affect any of those things. Well, okay then. It'll take you 30 seconds to prove that you didn't affect any of those things. Right, exactly. So even though I am 95% certain that there's nothing that we did messed up that, it would still be worth it to go in and test it and just find, just in case there's something you didn't think of, right? All right. We certainly could enable editing on this if we wanted to, on the grid view, so that they could go back and, like, change a date or something. We could put validation in for the save comment and so on. But again, the idea is that we've programmatically written this. How would you programmatically create a delete button? Almost the same way. Wherever you see insert, put delete. All right, and make sure you have the right parameters. How would you do programmatically an edit function? Well, the updating part would be just an update instead of an insert, right? Everything else would be the same. Pretty much a global substitute of insert or update for insert in all those. But the other thing we'd have to do is we'd have to pre-populate it. So when the page loaded, you would do a select, populate the form controls. When the save button was pressed, you would do like we're doing here, except you do an update instead of this. So even though we only went over the insert example, it's pretty easy to see how you could adopt this or adapt this to work for other sorts of things as well. Are there any questions? Read on Canvas a couple of last end of semester announcements that I made, all right, as far as my availability next week and when things are finally due. All right, if there are no further questions, we'll see you in lab. And I do need to borrow a thumb drive because mine is still missing.
What was that line? That like one line at the end, the object database for the to initiate it, put it in the try catch.
Which is insert.
Is it just okay?
This?
Yeah.
Yep. Right here. So 1 hour and 15 minute lecture to get one line.
Yeah, right.